Tonight, the cheapest 1911 we've ever reviewed. Will it be awesome, or will it give me a disease? Find out now on the 1911 Syndicate. It's a story as old as time itself. You're a couple old fashions deep, and you pick up your phone, looking to have a fun night with a perfect 10. A message is sent for a booty call from your local Chili's hostess, probably named Ashley. On that night, you wanted a 10, but all you could get was Ashley, a 3. I, on a similarly styled night of old fashions, apparently sent a message to a Turkish company named Tisas, asking to review the cheapest 1911 in the history of our show. Much like your drunken soiree, where you will eventually wake up next to Ashley and have to figure out what to do next, one day, I had a $580 1911 show up, to which I had to figure out, what do I do? But what if? What if that hoe Ashley wound up being your wife and you made babies together? She could bring you baby back ribs, and you set out to change the world together, or at least improve the service at Chili's. Well, what if the Tisas was the one for you? The 3 that refused to let that keep it down. Because, my friends, someone forgot to tell this Tisas that it's a cheap, dirty 1911.
Okay, everyone, welcome to the party today. Today we're looking at a budget 1911, and I'm going to open by telling you this. I feel like we've carved out our place as a channel that largely features higher-end firearms.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think that's a common thread within the comments section.
I think it is too. And while it may sound a little like, oh, big shot, with it's not meant that way. It's just meant statistically, if you look at our channel, I think we feature a lot of higher-end product.
Sure.
Much in the same way that, hey, I couldn't really afford much of what they featured on Top Gear, but it's like, I like watching it.
Which is always funny, right? When that's my argument, is like, I like watching that stuff even though I can't afford it. Right?
Yes. Yeah. So I'm going to give you some stats, okay? In the history of our show, we featured 33 different 1911s.
Wow.
Yeah, we've had 33 1911 reviews, including 2011s, but of the 1911 platform, 33 different 1911s. The total value of those, this is what I do, when I'm bored at home, I just add up this shit. So the total value of those 33 1911s comes out to $138,000. Okay?
Oh, my God.
So if you reverse engineer those numbers, the average cost of a 1911 Syndicate reviewed 1911 is $4,181. Okay?
That's crazy.
Yeah. Over the course of 33, the average has still stayed about $4,200.
Okay, that's crazy.
It's pretty wild, actually. Now, that makes it, in many ways, all the more confusing on why I reached out to Tisas to say I'd like to review your pistol.
When you told me that, I was like, am I talking to Jake
now? What are you doing?
You're like, I got an idea.
Yeah. And so I'm going to reiterate a point there. I reached out to them, which we do often. We reach out to companies, say, hey, we'd like to review on your product. Sometimes companies reach out to us. And but I reached out to them because I believe that it's sometimes important for us to come here and show you some attainable things. And this happens to be an attainable thing inside of the niche that some people affiliate us with, which is 1911s. So you go, all right, this is, by a decent margin, the cheapest 1911 we've ever showed you guys. And I initiated the damn thing.
Yeah.
Okay. So relationship with Tisas here, I will tell you, they sent the gun out for the review. I've had zero communication with them since the gun showed up.
Not for lack of effort.
No, I mean, I've reached out to, I mean, look, they're nice enough to, I reached out to them. They said, sure, we'll let you do a review. The gun showed up and, you know, and
That's it.
Cool. So it's like, okay, cool. Well, here's your review. So before we get into it, I actually do carry a 1911. And when I do that, I carry it with a belt made by a company named Ciguera.
Ciguera has the belts.
Yep.
The belts that I wear too.
Yeah. And that is what I actually EDC my 1911 in every day. I use the light inner Velcro belt. Yeah. I quite enjoy it. I do rock a multicam belt as my EDC. Does that make me an asshole? Maybe.
Depends.
Maybe. I don't know. But the code you guys can plug in is 1911 Syndicate. It's lowercase, no spaces. Saves you 10% off all their belts. Not just on the light inner Velcro, but the Emissary, the Battle Wagon. They got a host of different things. Yeah. A smorgasbord of belts.
If you will. Yeah. And I like the Battle Wagon for a battle belt.
Yes.
It stacks on top of the light inner belt, which we both wear.
It's true.
And check them out, guys. Thanks for your support.
Okay, everyone. So let's talk about this. I believe in any review that we do, it's important to judge a thing for what it is and not necessarily what you want it to be or what it is not.
Which can be difficult sometimes.
It can be, because you can start placing unrealistic expectations on a thing. Well, this is a budget gun, my friend.
Yeah.
So I think it's important that we keep that in mind as we go through the review. I have a question for you, okay? This is where I'm going to bring you into the conversation here, which is I want you to tell me your best case and worst case scenario of what you would expect from a $580 1911. What's the best you could hope for and what's the worst case?
Best I could hope for with it would just be like marginally impressed. Like, yeah, you know what? That's what I expect out of that price point and I'm happy with it. Worst case would be you buy that entry level and it just doesn't function in any way, shape or form. That would be the worst case in my opinion. Okay?
Okay. Cool.
Right?
Fair enough.
Yeah. I'm not talking like fit, finish, anything like that. I think for that price point, does it function, you know, say 300-400 rounds?
Okay.
Does it not function at all? That's the bar for me.
Okay. I obviously had more time to think about this. Sure. So I'm going to give you my, I was curious to kind of get your take on it, right? I'm going to give you my version of worst case for me. Worst case is the gun comes in its shit components. Like the actual components themselves are just hot garbage and it doesn't work. So it is neither reliable nor are the components worth a damn. Okay? Okay. That's the worst case scenario. The best case is you have good components and the gun works.
Okay.
Right? It'd be the inverse of the worst case. You just
What's considered good or bad components?
Well, we're going to get into
that. Okay. I wasn't sure if you were. I'm sorry.
We are. It's actually a good segue. So the next thing we will talk about is a few of the components here. Okay? That gun has a forged frame, forged slide, and a cold hammer forged barrel. And if those are three things I did not think I would say leading into this video.
You thought they would be what?
Just some bullshit, some cast stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, just some
super
cast
cheap
stuff and MIM parts all over the place. The fact that that gun is coming with, I mean, the main components are forged steel. Didn't think you'd see that.
No.
Didn't think you'd see that. Like that price point. That is punching above its pay grade is what that is. It's like, man, okay. I don't know how you guys are doing all that at that price point, but geez, I mean, Turkish labor, maybe not super expensive or something.
Something.
Tisas Turkish company, everyone. Yeah. That, for me, was very interesting when I got this. Let me tell you why I think that matters. There's a big market for 1911 customization, okay? What I mean by that is people taking a base gun and then building out said base gun to the specs that they want.
Sure.
OK. Okay. Now, historically, Colt has owned that market. It's not to say that you couldn't do it with other guns, but, you know, there's, and I don't know everything that goes into it, but it was like, hey, the raw materials of the Colts, like the steel and everything itself, is like lends well to being a base gun upon which you build and spec it out with, you know, improved internals and match grade barrels.
Oversized parts that you can fit to it, things of that sort.
Yeah, like if you're gonna customize a base gun, a Colt's typically the route you would do.
Okay.
And I'll be the first to tell you, when I originally got into guns, at this point over a decade ago, and ironically lived in California, of all places, I got into 1911s very quickly. I realized, hey, this is something I kind of enjoy, and I like the craftsmanship behind it. And I had quite a few customized Colts.
Yeah.
You know, get a base Colt and customize it. And
like the gold cup ones?
No, never that. But I mean, you know, I had a couple officers, you know, that got, you know, fitted with Packmeyer grips, Barstow barrels and all this kind of stuff. Some stuff that, you know, you're not a 1911 guy, so it might be a little obscure, but like.
No, I know what that is.
You know, good stuff, you know, and I would use Colts for this. Well, with that gun being that price, with that level of raw, good quality components, there's a very real case here for picking these up to go and doing your customization.
Okay.
Like, it's a very, very valid argument in favor of that gun. Next thing, I said, hey, best case scenario is it's got good components. Okay, we already talked about that. So okay. The next thing would be that it's reliable. Well, I'll tell you, I haven't had a damn malfunction on the thing today, minus a mag that was, the mag was just being funky and I just needed to tap the back of the slide.
Yep.
I don't count that as malfunction.
Not for the gun, for the mag.
No, yeah. So it's like, I haven't had a damn malfunction on that gun. And that's something I did not think I would be saying today.
Sure.
That I have not had a malfunction on that gun. Because I've had all kinds of cool guy guns that have had malfunctions.
Mm-hmm.
And that's fine. Malfunction's not bad. I mean, you would rather not have a malfunction, but malfunction here and there is fine.
If we can diagnose it, fix it, and it never happens again, we're good to go.
Life happens.
Yep.
But it's like zero reliability issues on that, and hot damn. If you guys are looking for any ways to support the channel, we would appreciate it. Just go to 1911syndicate.com. I mean, the website's just amazing. I mean, it's the most amazing website in the world. There's all kinds of entertaining things that are on there. There's a shop page with apparel and things like this.
Get some merch, some shirts.
About to have hoodies come out. I don't know if they'll be out at this time, but stay tuned.
It's getting close to hoodie weather.
Yeah, we're getting close. Definitely not today.
As it's 110 out here.
You know, hoodies. Hey, at the end of the day, 1911 Syndicate is a real estate business. That's the main way that we stay in business, is you guys calling us, sending us a message on the website when you need to buy or sell a house. We will get back to you. Even those of you that send us very weird requests about real estate things, we always get back to you. We just, you know, we focus our attention where we can actually make some deals happen. Okay. Take you through a brief tour. This is not going to be a super long video. So this is can you drop the slide on that? I don't know why it's slide back. Just aesthetically, it's just like, ugh. So this is the Tisas Duty B9R. That's the model. Okay. When Tisas was like, which one would you want to review? I pulled up the site and I was like, here's a few. And like, literally that just showed up one day.
Oh,
I was like, okay, well, fortunately you guys sent one that I was interested in. As mentioned, that is $580. I mean, that's a sub $600 gun. That's MSRP. Who knows? I don't even know. You might be able to get them cheaper than that, like if you go shop around. I got no clue. But I mean, at $580 MSRP, I mean, geez, you don't expect too much, yet forged components and no reliability issues. Slide to frame fit, always first thing I do when I get a new 1911. I can tell you this, it's a hell of a lot better than a Colt. It's a hell of a lot better than a base Colt. There's the slightest bit of play in there, really not much. I certainly don't imagine that's a hand-fit gun. I would certainly assume that's a machine-fit gun. That would seem like a big ass to have a gun at that price point that's getting much in the way of hand-fitment. But the machining's clearly good, because, I mean, like, look, it's a good slide-to-frame fit. There's very little play in there. I mean, you're like, it seems like there's actually some pretty decent tolerance in this. The trigger, so that's the second thing I do. First thing I do is I make sure the gun's unloaded. Next thing I do is I check, fit, finish kind of thing. Next thing I do is I dry fire the trigger just to see, okay, 1911s have the best triggers that are you can get in a pistol. So how's the trigger? That trigger is damn good, man. Like the
it's
trigger
not
is-
terrible.
No, it's, no. I'd say it's a lot better than not terrible. Not terrible is like, it's all right. Like, that's a good trigger. That's like probably a 3.5 to 4 pound clean trigger. There's not much in the way of mush or anything. Like, it's clean. It's a good break. It's a good reset. And I'm just like, okay, Tisas, with your good trigger and your forged components and your no malfunctions. Like, fuck me, man.
How many people at this point are going to say you just got paid to say all of this.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure. Yeah. I'm sure.
Because I am shocked at how much you like this gun.
Well, we're going to keep going.
Yeah.
Okay. So obviously that's a railed model. So you can attach your light and all that kind of stuff. Comes with rubber grips. Hey, the grips, they ain't nothing to write home about. They're just some standard BS rubber grips.
They're there.
Okay? You know, yeah. I'm not going to say the gun's like, I'm not going to say it's a Nighthawk. I'm reviewing it again for what I said earlier. Review it for what it is. Rubber grips, they're nothing notable. They're placeholders. Think of them like Glock sights. You're going to replace those.
Sure.
Unless, but we'll get there. There's no checkering on the front strap or the mainspring housing. There is some, you know, kind of, I wouldn't call it serrations, but actually,
texture.
I would actually probably would call it serrations, but I wouldn't call it checkering. It's not checkering, but it, like, there is a little bit of texture here. The front strap is totally smooth. So that, again, would be one of those things that if you choose to send this gun off to get custom things done to it, the first things, you know, that I'd probably be doing would be, you know, just working on the overall grip. We'll kind of get to that more as we go. There's no magwell. As you'll see, that does make reloads pretty challenging with this. Anytime you've got this mag and this
a box
gun,
into a box.
Yeah. Without a magwell, it really is it's not the world's fastest
reload.
You
want to funnel into the box.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. There's, you know, so a magwell would go a long way on that. The thumb safety, so again, everything's clear that way, everyone. So ambidextrous thumb safety on a sub $600 gun. you know, the thumb safety is not great. In fact, I would argue per the standards of good ambi thumb safeties, it's actually not good.
But
it is there and it does work and I've had no issues with
it. At that price point.
Would I change it? Yeah, I would, but
it's not what we're talking about.
It exists, and I have had no issues with it. So it's like you can't really fault something that's been fine.
Yeah.
Like, what are you going to say? I think it could be better, but it's also fine.
Yeah.
You know? So 5-inch barrel. It is a bushing barrel, aka it's not a bull barrel. So yeah, you need your bushing wrench. Those of you, you know, young kids with your 2011s, you can figure out what it's like to use a bushing tool and actually take a 1911 apart like a real man. This one is in 9mm. They do make it, I believe, in 45. I got it in 9mm because the reality is I've got 1911s in 45, and they're simply a lot less enjoyable to shoot and a lot more expensive to shoot and less capacity. And the reality is, man, a 9mm single stack 1911 is a very nice, very soft shooting
very
platform.
Nice gun to shoot.
So it's just really, really nice. Again, sub $600 gun. Comes with perfectly adequate serrations, front and rear, so you can do your press checks. White dot sights, Novak style rear sight, so you're not doing any cool guy racks off of your Ciguera belts or holsters.
Correct.
Or anything like that. But that also largely doesn't matter because you could take the ejection port and do anything you need to do. So before everyone freaks out, and that's the beauty of something like this, is I don't care what happens to this gun. It makes no difference to me. It was $580.
Why are you talking to me like you're mad at me right now?
I'm not.
Oh, okay.
I'm almost mad at the system. I've had $138,000 worth of 1911s on the channel, and the $600 gun's kicking the ass of some of these other things. So some overall thoughts. There's two routes that you can go with a gun like this or this gun. Option one, send it off and have some work done. What work would I have done if I were personally, well, I mean, it is my gun, I guess, but what work would I personally have done? I'd change the sights. I would change the thumb safety. I would change the grips, and I would checker the front strap and the mainspring housing.
Okay? Magwell?
You know, I've debated this, because the question you run into is, at what point are you putting, are you going beyond what you should be doing on a baseline gun? I'm telling my personal, yeah, this is what I would do.
Only reason why is because we see that often with other firearms, other platforms. Entry-level price is very low, and then people will dump $1,500 into them.
Yeah, you're like, you just bought a $2,000 1911. Like, what's the difference then?
So you see why I said that?
Yes, like, I do. Personally, sights, safety, and I need better grip.
Top three.
Okay? Those are my three things that I would do. I probably wouldn't do a magwell, because again, this wouldn't be my primary training gun, so I don't care that much about the magwell.
Be a beater range gun.
Yeah. Option two on what you do, what I would do with this gun, or what I think you might consider doing with this gun, don't do a damn thing to it and leave it as a beater.
Yeah.
Don't do anything to it.
Yeah.
Just leave it exactly how it is and go get a nicer gun when you want to go shoot a nicer gun.
Sure.
Or you want a showpiece to show your friends. I told some friends this when they shot it, or, you know, they were asking me about it. I said, this gun's better than it has any business being. You know, it's like someone forgot to tell this gun that it's less than $600. Is kind of how I quickly, the first day I shot it was at an indoor range, and I was like, that gun has no business being as good as it is. You know, it's like, it's almost inspiring frustrating at the same time, where you're like, that gun shouldn't be that good. It shouldn't. And again, I'm not telling you this is the best gun in the world. I'm not. No. I'm telling you,
for the price point,
for what it is, it's outstanding.
Did you replace the mag catch spring?
No, it's heavy as hell.
Wow. Okay.
So it comes with a heavy as shit mag catch
spring.
Well,
for a lefty, that's important for you, which
is
why.
Yeah, because what happens for me as a lefty, for those that you might have seen it on camera at some point, that's where my grip lines up. This pressure that's being applied here winds up hitting, if you see really where that hand is, it's applying pressure on top of this. So when I have really kind of weak springs, I'll just drop mags, you know, and it's really frustrating.
Yeah.
This comes with a very heavy spring. Like, you're not dropping mags on this.
So
gun.
Jake legitimately has to do nothing to that pistol.
Nothing. Ambidextrous safety, heavy mag release spring. You're just like, and they didn't know that. It's not like they did that for me.
I was just curious.
You know, they just pulled this thing off an assembly line in Turkey and sent it to the US, and here it is. So look, man, if all you care about is functionality, then you really got something here. Because it functionally does what you need it to do at a more than fair price point. Now, I will still tell you, I am a sucker and a believer in the romanticism of the 1911, including single stacks, where it's like, I love the hand fitting and the old school stuff and oversized parts
the 1911
and blending.
Time frame.
It's the 1911 experience of just like America's pistol, which is not the, I don't even think people that don't like the 1911 would debate that. It's like the 1911 is America's pistol.
Yeah. Just made in Turkey.
Yeah. But it's just like, my point to it is like, look, 100%, a gun like this has a place for me as a beater. I wouldn't do a damn thing to this gun.
Okay.
This does not replace any of the other stuff that I have. I still love all of that stuff. I will continue to buy all that other stuff. I'm not about to start collecting Tisas guns. I'm not adding 20 of these. I'm not sponsored by Tisas. I'm not paid by Tisas. I think that's a damn good gun for the price point. And for those of you that have maybe considered, I'd like to get a 1911, test it out, but I don't want to go spend $4,000 on a Wilson or something. Well, look no further, friends.
Yeah.
Look no further. You got something there. And if you want to go buy from an American company, do that. But it's like, hey, look, there's a Turkish company making a damn good gun. It's what it is. That's it. That's all I got.
Cool. Now, say you had to use this in like a legally justified self-defense scenario. What would you hope you had?
I'm going to cut it down right to the chase. I want firearms legal protection.
Yeah.
Because it's insurance.
It's insurance for self-defense scenarios, as long as they're legally justified. Our code 1911 saves you about a third off each package. He has the single guy package. Yeah, I have the married traveler package, so my wife is covered.
Yep.
They also, if you were in a situation, when you call, attorney answers the phone. You make a mess, they send a team to clean it out. You need a bail bond help, they got that covered.
I got that guy.
How many for attorney fees? How much?
Unlimited.
So you guys need a concealed carry insurance, which you all should need if you carry concealed. Check those guys out. Firearms Legal Protection.
See you guys next time.
Thanks, guys.